Welcome to the first NGS Member Connects meeting in 2023. My name is Bernice Alexander Bennett, and I am a member of the NGS Membership Committee and MC for tonight's meeting. The discussion tonight is for all individuals interested in the USCIS and not just our members. The focus of the discussion tonight is why the U.S. Citizenship and Immigration Services fee increases matter. I want to emphasize that we are not discussing how to use these records tonight and will focus entirely on a call to action. So we are excited to have three records access advocates join us tonight for this important discussion. Rich Venezia lives in Philadelphia and specializes in 20th century immigration research. He also coordinates week-long genealogical research classes about immigration records with fellow presenter Marian Smith. A records access advocate, he founded Records Not Revenue in 2019. Renee Carl is a professional genealogist based in Washington, D.C. Renee and Rich worked on two seasons of PBS Genealogical Roadshow together, and when Rich founded Records Not Revenue, he recruited Renee out of her public policy and advocacy retirement to provide policy guidance. Marian Smith led the history program within the records division of USCIS in Washington for several decades. Her most recent work focused on digitization and data integrity in relation to USCIS old records and documenting old record location and retrieval processes. Now, Marian joined this merry band of records access advocates to help ensure continued access to the records she spent decades bringing to light. And I will now turn this program over to these fantastic experts, the merry band of records access, and Rich is going to lead us on.
Hello, thanks so much for your introductions, Bernice, and thanks so much to NGS for having us. We're really thrilled to be here. We're thrilled that so many of you are here to learn more and to help us in this effort. Let me get my slide shared here. Okay. So we'll say from the beginning that we've got quite a lot to cover. We're going to talk about what the USCIS Genealogy Program is and what changes are being proposed to the program. We're going to briefly talk about what records the program has and how they are unique. We're going to discuss the issues with the program. We're going to talk about what a proposed rule is. And most importantly, we are going to talk about how you can help. So we'll say upfront that we have quite a lot to cover in not a lot of time, but we want to remind you that this meeting is being recorded, so you can refer back to it later. It will be available for you within a few days. And of course, there's going to be much more information about what we talk about, as well as examples of the records at our website, which is recordsnotrevenue.com. We ask that folks who have questions during the presentation type them into the chat with a Q, a capital Q at the beginning of them, so we can quickly identify them as a question, and then we can pull them out for the Q&A at the end of the talk. So I'm going to turn it over now to Marian to talk a little bit more about the history of the program.
Thank you, Rich. I'm going to start here with one of two things I wanted to cover just at the very beginning. One is just to orient you as far as the historical meaning, and then also a little bit about the genealogy program. I'm showing you a timeline, of course, or a chart of immigration since 1820. And I've circled there in red, or I squared it, I guess, the period that these records cover from the late 19th century through into the 1950s. These are the records that are the responsibility of the USCIS genealogy program to release. And I wanted to make the point that the USCIS's historical records are important not just to individuals, you know, genealogists who would love to get a file on their immigrant ancestor or their grandpa, but also to the country. During this period, from the 1890s, which begins the Ellis Island era and federal regulation of immigration through the 1917 Act, and then as it was modified by the 24 Act, which brings us the limited immigration. You can see the drop there in the 20s. And then in the 1940 and in the 52, all the laws were brought together into the 1952 Act, the INA, which is still the law that we live under today. So we can see that 20th century immigration is what built the system that we have today. And so it is not just important to us as individual researchers, but also to the nation's history. And so these records have a lot of value. Also remember, they've got these little phases here. And of course it says up there that like the major sending regions of whoever made this chart, the Population Research Bureau, they're still saying that these are coming from Europe and Western Europe. And it's true. But it's also a time with World War I and the 20s, where we start to get a lot of immigration from the South, from Mexico, from the Caribbean. And also it's in this period when a lot of the Asian immigrants who came in the late 19th or early 20th century under Chinese exclusion or Asian exclusion later will be brought into the records after the repeal of those policies. And so there's so much to be that gives this record, all these records value. And I think that we have to keep that in mind. The second is has to do with the program and how it works. Thanks. And I think it's just important because so much of this is confusing. And I think it just helps a simple look at it. This is the process left to right. And there's two steps in some cases. At left, your 1041 is the USCIS genealogy index search request. That would be the first step. It costs $65. You submit that, and USCIS will search their master index, their big index, to all the different records. They don't know what they're going to find until they search it. It could be one of the five colorful series of records that you see listed there. Rich will talk to you about them in a minute. Or even a sixth one at the bottom that is at the National Archives. If they found one of those, the correspondence files at the bottom for you, then your letter would just tell you, here's your file number, you can request it at the National Archives. But if it's one of those five that still are in USCIS custody, then they will send you a letter providing the file number that they found, if they found one, and you would go to the second step, the G1041A, the genealogy record request. And that incurs another fee of $65. You use the number you got from the first request to identify the record in this record request, and then you would receive your file. So that's the flow and how it works. The proposed change and the proposed rule we're gonna hear about has a couple of different things. The first, you can see it left. One change is they're raising the fees. The index search went up from 65 to 100, but you still submit it. They still search their index. And it largely works as before, except you can see the two things at the top. C files from 1906 to 44. These are the naturalization files, and the alien registration forms from World War II years. Those had been digitized. And so what they're proposing is, if they find one of those, they'll just send it to you for your $100 index search. Now, I have to say, you don't get to choose what they find. It's not optional. If they find one of the colorful ones there in the middle, the four left that are on paper, then it works as before. You have to then take the number they send you, submit the record request, which now the fee has gone up to $240 in order to actually receive a copy of the file. So the fees go up, and they have changed the procedure as far as digitized files. And this is going to make, this might, I hope, will help you when you hear Renee to understand what she's talking about a little more. So this is summarizes it again, the differences between now and the proposed rule. So I know that was quick and very simplified high level, but I thought it would orient people a little to what they're going to hear tonight.
Great, thanks so much, Marian. So we'll talk a little bit now about the records of the genealogy program. There's five different file series that are serviced through the program: the C files, the BEAST files, the registry files, alien registration forms, historical A files, and as Marian was noting, the index to subject and correspondence files, which are held at the National Archives. So C files relate to naturalizations that occurred between September 1906 and March 1956, but they don't just relate to court naturalization records. USCIS also maintains records for derivative citizens or repatriating citizens who would have applied directly to the INS, which is the preceding agency to the USCIS, if they needed their own certificate, or if they had accidentally expatriated themselves, maybe by voting in the foreign election or serving in a foreign army. And some of these odd records aren't held anywhere else except by the USCIS genealogy program. C files might also contain other files. They consolidated other files into C files. So it might contain a consolidated A file, visa file, or registry file. When we talk about the C files, we're talking about around 6.5 million digitized files and about 3 million paper files. So when we look at what that would look like under the proposed fee, it would be a $100 total fee if the record has been digitized, or a $240 total fee if the record is still on paper. If you don't know the file number, that would then also require the extra $100 index search fee. If the components of the file are both digital and paper, we're unsure, based upon the current rule, what that fee would be. Seemingly would be a $240 fee at minimum. So here's an example of what one of these files might look like. Here's an a repatriation C file. So we see here an individual's application. It includes an affidavit, the examination or the examiner's findings, an oath of allegiance, a letter in regards to his certificate, and of course, a duplicate copy of his certificate of repatriation. Most of the documents within this file, you would only be able to obtain by doing a USCIS genealogy program records request. Under the new fees, this file would cost $240. Visa files are another one of the file series serviced by the genealogy program. They're a direct result of the Immigration Act of 1924. All non-citizens under this act were required to have a visa. And so there are 3 million paper visa files for individuals who arrived between July 1st, 1924 and March 31st, 1944. To obtain one of these files, it's a it would be a $340 total fee, as you're required to do an index search in order to get the visa file number. When you obtain a visa file, you would get a photograph of the individual as well as information about their arrival. It would also likely include a copy of their birth record, copies of police certificates or other court certificates from their country of origins. It might also include a copy of a marriage record, a copy of the family status, and that application for a visa itself. As you can see here, it's quite a valuable document. And these records are actually scheduled overdue for transfer to the National Archives, but yet are still on the docket for USCIS to raise the fees on. Registry files are documents they're created for immigrants when no arrival record could be found. So this mostly pertains to individuals who later naturalized. These records document both arrival and residence in the United States. These relate to individuals who arrived between June of 1906 and July of 1924. If for some reason their arrival was irregular or they had to legalize their status, undergoing registry proceedings would allow them to do that. These relate to 250,000 paper files. So that would also be a $340 total fee. Most of the time, you're not going to be able to get a file number for these without doing an index search first. So the alien registration forms are forms that would have been filled out by all aliens living in the United States in the early 1940s. So this relates to over 5.5 million individuals who are living here or who are arriving into the country at that time. This is the only series that's held by the USCIS genealogy program that is fully digitized. As such, that would be a $100 total fee to obtain these records, as you would do an index search request, and they would be able to provide a digitized copy of that file. So here's an example of what one of these files might look like. You see it's 2 pages, but it includes extremely valuable information, including date and place of arrival, as well as date, place of origin. Historical alien files are unfortunately one of the most complicated records held by or serviced through the genealogy program, as A files are serviced through a couple of different means. However, the A files that are serviced through the genealogy program relate to individuals who were resident in the country or arriving into the country between April of 1944 and April of 1951. These records were created to streamline record keeping because they were trying to put all of the files that related to one individual in one place, as opposed to having a bunch of different files related to the same person in different offices or in different file series. We don't actually know how many paper files these records relate to, but it's around 4 to 5 million, certainly no more than 8 million, but we believe it to be somewhere between 4 to 6 million paper files. Because these are on paper, this is a $240 total fee. If you have the alien registration number, the A number, or it'll be a $340 total fee if you needed to first do the index search to obtain that number. Here's an example of some things that you might find in an alien file. Alien files became the official record for all immigrants' records, including naturalizations after 1956. So an A file might include a certificate of naturalization, the petition for naturalization. This individual also had quite a bit of difficulty in regards to her immigration to the United States. So she had to appeal to Congress and get a special bill passed to legalize her status. And so there's information on that congressional bill and the hearings, the act that wound up being passed. correspondence between Congress and the INS, information about an ordered deportation because her temporary stay had been had expired, as well as various applications to extend her temporary stay, and letters that also reference other file numbers. For instance, one of the letters in this A file references one of the subject and policy files that are the ones held at the National Archives, which Marian was talking about earlier. So even though the INS correspondence files or the INS subject and policy files are held at the National Archives, the only index to these records, the only complete index to these records is held by USCIS. And as such, in order to obtain a file number to look for a file of a deportation or a Board of Special Inquiry decision appeal, you would need to do a USCIS genealogy program index search, which under the proposed fee would be an $100 total fee. You get back a letter that looks like this, and then you might be able to obtain a file like this at the National Archives. In this case, while the file held at the National Archives is quite interesting and useful, noting that the individual had expatriated himself, it was only one page. And so it would be an $100 fee to obtain a file, which might be 100 pages or might be only one page. A reminder that you can see examples of all of the different types of records serviced through the USCIS Genealogy Program at our website, records.revenue.com. As we noted, we wanted the main crux of tonight's presentation to be about how to preserve access to these records under this new proposed rule, as opposed to a how-to on the records themselves. So I'll pass over now to Renee to discuss first some of the issues of the genealogy program.
Thank you, Rich. And thank you to the NGS team for dealing with what was going on in the background. It happens, but I think we all need to acknowledge that that was unfortunately a little distracting during Rich's talk, but you can see other examples of these files and additional information at records.revenue.com. And we do hope that Rich's brief overview of all these records has you interested and intrigued. And if you've never had a chance to work with them before, you're wondering, do I want to dive into this? How am I going to dive into this? How am I going to spend all my vacation money and all my conference money to buy these records? But I want to take you back to when the USCIS genealogy program launched. I want to make sure, Rich and Marian, you can hear me okay? Okay. The USCIS genealogy program launched in 2008, and the press release presented it as a dedicated queue for genealogists, historians, and others seeking genealogical and historical records and reference services that generally require no FOIA expertise. As a result, USCIS will provide more timely responses to requests for records of deceased individuals. Now, before I go to the next slide, I do want to take a moment and just give you what FOIA means. That's Freedom of Information Act. And what FOIA is designed to do is give people access to records that are not yet at the National Archives or available somewhere else. But in this particular case with USCIS records, it is looking to protect personal information of living individuals or people born less than 100 years ago. That does not apply to a huge majority of the records that we're talking about today. So we'll go on. And what I'm setting up here is a very classic case of how it started with these great ideas and hopes of moving records quickly out of the, at the time, INS storage at the Federal Record Centers to the paying customers to what we have today. Now, this is a decade's worth of data that Records Not Revenue has collected. And I'm going to ask Rich to park the mouse if he could. Thank you. And so this graph is showing that, you know, there's been some ebbs and flows over time in the past 10 years. But if you look over to the right third of this graph, starting in sometime in 2020, now granted 2020 was a crazy time for everybody, but you would think by now we would start to see some post-pandemic recovery in their ability to service records. But the opposite is happening. The trend line is suggesting an almost vertical increase in the amount of time it is going to take to provide paying customers their record requests, both the index search and the records requests. And I already saw a question and we'll be able to answer it right now. We'll go to the next slide, please. That the current wait time on average for an index search request is 245 business days. A records request averages 275 business days. So you're talking 2+ years if you need an index search request and a records request, those two forms that Marian spoke about. These record requests were once promised in 90 days or less. So the other thing that we are seeing, people email us, they send us messages about what's going on with their requests. And what we're seeing is more and more files are going through extensive FOIA review. This is exactly why the program was created and what the program sought to avoid. So we know from correspondence also that customers are not receiving their information, their file can't be found. And what that means is both index searches are coming back with no results, when those of us who are familiar enough with the records know there should be a record. But they're also then, once the records are being requested and you're paying that second fee, the records are not being located. And so that's a records management issue. So there are two things happening here. Now, granted, the index search is a really, really complicated thing. It's not like going to Ancestry or Family Search or MyHeritage or whatever your favorite place is to do your research online. It is a many-to-many index. So that means you have a variety of different ways to search and a variety of different things that are come back to you. And you also have to have people who understand not only the immigration laws, but also the internal INS, USCIS processes. So was it a should I be looking for a consolidated file? Should I be looking for a visa file? Did this person naturalize or not? At what time did they naturalize? Is it derivative? There is a million different permutations of things that can happen. And so if people are not being trained to properly use the MIDAS system, this is why we're not getting the results that we anticipate. And as the previous graph showed, and you probably can do the math and figure out, there's this 2+ years long backlog. And USCIS, despite many requests by records advocates, and with USCIS doing a really, I do want to take, we're going hard at USCIS. And the past couple of years, the agency has been really beleaguered. There are a lot of things happening to undermine the efforts of the people who are working there. And a lot in the past 2 years has been going on to improve their services. Yet the one place they have not addressed and the one area they are not doing any additional work, at least that we know, because we've asked for answers and we've not been provided them. And that's our issue with what's going on at USCIS. There's no plan. And so they roll out this proposed rule. And I'm going to explain the language on what a proposed rule in a second is. But it's two parts. And we're going to go back to Marian's chart. So we have a fee hike. But then we also have structural changes to the program and to document delivery. So as Marian explained, this proposed rule would put in place, if approved as is, this process where you have an index search request at $100, They do their work, they do their thing. If the records are digitized, they will be provided to you. If the records are not digitized and they find a couple of things, that's at least $240 per file. But if all you're wanting is a correspondence file number to records that were sent to the National Archives decades ago without the corresponding index, you've paid $100 for a file number, and then you've got to go down to Pennsylvania Avenue and request the record or have someone go get it for you. And then on top of all of this, if we think about the numbers that exist right now, this process will take over 2 years from start to finish. All right, so the other lingo that we've been using a lot of today is what is a proposed rule? We can go back one slide, please. The federal process for independent agencies in the executive branch. It's their way of amending policy, changing policy, developing and issuing rules. Now you can learn more about this, not at Schoolhouse Rock, but at regulations.gov/learn. Now it's confusing because I keep saying rules and they say regulations. And actually when you go to their website, it says you can say rules or regulations, they're used interchangeably. So we are currently in a proposed rulemaking comment period. So it happened that the USCIS issued the proposed rule at the beginning of January. We have until the 6th of March to provide comments. So USCIS says, hey folks, what do you think about all these changes we're gonna do to the USCIS program? Sound good? And we're like, no, not good. And the public can make comments. The next step is USCIS takes all these comments. They will run them through and look for similarities. If there are too many similar comments, they will start to weed those out. This is why, which Rich will talk about more, we ask you to personalize your comment. This is why we don't follow a process a lot of larger advocacy organizations do, which is to give you a form. We don't give you a form because they will not pay attention to it. So we're hoping they're reviewing and analyzing all these personal comments. They might modify their rule based on the feedback. They might withdraw it, which is incredibly unlikely. And then they will publish all of that in what's called the Federal Register. And I'm going to kick it back to Rich, and he will talk more about what is the Federal Register and how you can make your comments.
Okay. Sorry, unmuting. So the Federal Register is the place where they put all of the different proposed rules, as well as the final rules once they are published, as well as various other federal notices. We have broken down our process in how to take action on this topic into three easy steps, as noted on our website, recordsnotrevenue.com. We first encourage individuals to read the proposed rule, which you can get to by clicking on the link on the homepage of our website. You can click on the link to the main part of the rule, which will take you to the Federal Register. Or you could also click on the link that gets you specifically to the section about the genealogy and records. There's a lot of confusing language, and it is quite a lengthy rule. So we don't want you to be overwhelmed. We have distilled the information and also the issues that we have with both the rule and the genealogy program itself at the section of our website titled The Issues. So while we do encourage you to read the rule, we also want to make sure that you know that we've distilled the main aspects of the rule and the issues within on our website. Then we want individuals to start writing some comments. Also on our website, we have comment starters. As Renee noted, we don't want individuals to copy and paste this comment page or to save it as a PDF and attach it as your comment, because as noted, they will discount the comments that are duplicates. As such, if 1,000 people copy and paste the website, one that will count as one comment. So that's why we really encourage you to use these comment starters as a guide to help you perhaps begin to organize your thoughts, but not to copy and paste the information from this site. We recommend that you draft your comment using Microsoft Word or another word processor so you can save your work as you go. Once you've written your comment, hold that thought for 1 second. As noted on regulations.gov, a single well-supported comment may carry more weight than 1,000 form letters. So again, please make sure that you use our comment starters as a guide. When you're ready to submit your comment, you can navigate to the federal rulemaking portal. Again, linked directly from the homepage of our website. You can either attach your comment by dropping the file and putting in your email address and opting in to receive confirmation of your submission. Or alternatively, you can write the comment directly into the text box. There is a 5,000 character limit. And again, because we recommend writing in MS Word or another word processor, we would recommend in this case that you copy and paste onto this form as opposed to writing directly in the form because there is not an option to save. Again, make sure to write in your email address and opt in to receive a confirmation that your submission was received. You can then select whether you're an individual, an organization, or anonymous. If you click individual, they'll ask for your first and last name as the only required information, but they also do ask for your city, state, zip, country, and phone number, as well as the CAPTCHA code. Now, something to keep in mind here is that individuals do not need to be US citizens nor US residents to comment on this rule. As such, if you are located internationally, but you have an interest in or believe these records are important, USCIS, we'll hear from anyone who has an interest in these records. Once you've completed that, written the comment, input your email address, input your contact information, and done the CAPTCHA, you can submit your comment. There is also an option to comment directly on the Federal Register, which looks essentially the same as the one just shown to you. Please be sure to comment in one or the other. Commenting in both will just mean a duplicate comment is posted as they both go to the regulations.gov comments portal. We also want individuals to send a copy of their comments and any concerns they have about the genealogy program to their senators and representative. So of course, for this, you would need to be a US citizen or a US resident in order to do that. And you can find more information on how to get contact details for your senators and representative, again, on the homepage of our website. USCIS is a federal agency, and as such, Congress does have some oversight of USCIS. So as a constituent having problems with a federal agency, we recommend getting in touch with your elected officials and providing them a copy of your comment so that way they can register your concerns and get in touch with USCIS about them. I believe it is time to kick it back to Renee now to talk a little bit more about some of these final steps.
Thanks, Ritz. And we're, just so everyone knows, we're about to wrap up so we can get to some of these really good questions that we're seeing come through. I will emphasize again, please contact your senators and representative. It's essential that they hear your feedback about the proposed rule and about any issues you might be having with USCIS. USCIS does not receive annual appropriations from Congress, so they do not undergo a hearing process to get their money. We are paying customers. They operate on fees. So if you're an unhappy customer and you're not receiving what you need from USCIS, you can ask your member of Congress for help, just like the example Rich showed you of the A-file. You know, it's not a new thing. Our ancestors and our relatives and the people we research went to Congress for help, and they've done that for a long time. There are two things to focus on, right? One is what's going on with USCIS, not only the proposed rule, but also the other issues that you or others might be having. The second part of this is that USCIS needs to be to play better in the sandbox, so to speak, and they need to work with the National Archives, and they need to transfer the historical records on the record schedule that they're so behind on. And they need to transfer these records with the accompanying index and make it so that the National Archives are receiving the records in a way that they can then service them to us. Because if we don't act, if we're not vocal about it, if we don't volunteer every waking moment, because Rich and I are volunteers and we, and Marian's supposed to be retired. If we're not vocal about it, the records are not going to save themselves. The records are not going to be available to us. And this will be the future of USCIS records. $100 search fee, a black box of USCIS where you can't get information barely in, you can't get anything out. You've got these dark, stormy clouds thinking, why are the records not at archives? And how much is this actually going to cost? You're waiting an inordinate amount of time, and you might end up paying far more than attending the next NGS conference to get your records. I mean, $240 per record if it's on paper. We really need your help. We really appreciate your time this evening. You can stay in touch with us, not only by going to recordsnotrevenue.com with resources, information, and ways to take action, but also you can email us at recordsnotrevenue@gmail.com. So thank you all so much.
Okay, I'd like to thank you, all three of you, for the excellent information you provided us tonight. And we do have questions coming in. I want to emphasize that we would like your questions to focus on what we're talking about tonight, and that's understanding the proposed fee increases and the call to action. So before I get into some of the questions that have been pouring in here, please focus again on the questions that relate to the call to action, the three steps that were presented to you. Now, the first question I do have, though, is what is the USCIS rationale for their increase? And what are your suspicions of their real motives?
Renee, do you want to take that one?
So USCIS has to explain their rationale for the fee increase in their rule. We don't believe they do a very good job of it, but their explanation is simply a fee calculation based on the level of effort to do the request start to finish. The issue is that USCIS does not have a discrete budget for the genealogy program. So there is no transparency and there's no ability for us to be able to see, are they really spending this money in the way they're spending it? We don't even know how many employees are assigned to the USCIS genealogy program. They used to say there were six, Now they say there are about six. I mean, there are things we could conjecture, but we just don't know. And so I think I'll leave it at that. Rich, if you have anything else to add, you can, you know, there's no transparency. So it is very difficult.
Yeah, I think I would just add briefly that, you know, for us, when we see high fees like this, a lot of people think, oh, well, the program just wants to make money. And, you know, we have a lot of suspicions that about a lot of things in relation to the program, but in terms of the actual money, you know, the genealogy program is not a good source of revenue at all for the agency. You know, it is less than one tenth of 1% of the agency's budget for an entire year. And so it's not that, you know, the agency is going to get rich off of our records requests. However, we don't really, as Renee was noting, understand how they come to the conclusion of how much the program costs when they don't actually have a discrete budget of the program.
Okay, Rich, could you please just reiterate when those public comments are due? We need to hear that date over and over again.
Yes, thanks, Bernice. The comments are due March 6th, which is a Monday, a week from Monday at 11:59 p.m. Eastern. So make sure that you get them in well before that. But in case you are on a different coast, it is Eastern time that the portal will close, March 6th at 11:59 p.m. Eastern.
Yeah, don't wait till the last moment because your internet might go out at the wrong time. There was a Grant just reminded us of something, which was, how is this different than in 2020 when USCIS unsuccessfully proposed a fee hike? And there are a number of things that are different, particularly politically. We have a different administration. We have a different operation and set of standards at USCIS. But the most important thing is we had a massive outpouring of support in 2020, and we have a bit of a way to go before we come close to matching the number of comments that we had last time. However, as Rich said, a great, well-constructed comment is far more important than 50 comments saying, don't raise the fees. Grant, I'm not sure if I quite got what you were getting at, but I tried.
Okay, and is there any potential of the GAO looking into the issues since this process is so obfuscated? What about asking the questions of our senators and representatives?
Mary's shaking her head, so we're going to.
The GAO has, of course, traditionally done all kinds of studies of INS, USCIS operations, usually when there is congressional interest or like at congressional direction. So I think we would still start with contacting your representatives.
Representatives, right.
And I would add to that first step would be the oversight committees in the House and the Senate, because while USCIS does not go through annual appropriations, they do have oversight hearings on USCIS. Now, I don't think we're going to get a oversight hearing on the genealogy program. However, we do know that members of the committee are aware of this. It would be helpful if more members of the committee heard from more people to raise the issue. Congress has 1,000,001 issues. They need to know which ones are important to their constituents.
And as Judy noted in the chat, brilliantly, thank you, Judy. When I worked with two different state senators, we counted letters from constituents representing at least 10 other people who didn't write, but have the same issue. So your letter to your Congress member is very important, because using that logic, 10 letters to the same congressperson represents 100 people having that issue. So again, just really underlining the importance of not only making your comment, but also engaging with your elected officials.
Great. Good point, Rich. And how many people made comments the last time? And did USCIS listen to those comments?
I don't know if we have data immediately available to us. There were tens of thousands of comments on the rule as a whole, and there were at least several thousand with the genealogy program noted specifically. We don't have that data readily available. I'm sorry that we don't. But as noted, but between the proposed rule in November of 2019 and the final rule, which was published in August of 2020, but was then later enjoined by two different courts, they did reduce the fees that they were going to place on the genealogy program. And we do, they were still higher. They have not gone into effect because of those court enjoyments, but we do believe that they went back and looked at those fees specifically because of the number of people that commented specifically in regards to the genealogy program.
Okay, and then there's another question. It relates to the campaign. Have you considered rolling this out in a big way at Roots Tech? I mean, you will have a large audience, and this will be before March 6th.
I'm going to answer part of that before Rich answers the rest. We're a merry band of warriors. There's other folks that do help us out, but we are all volunteers. We take $0 to do this. So rolling a campaign out at Roots Tech, Rich will be there. Find him. He has some things to say and some things to hand out. But we need your help. That's how we roll this out big, is we need the community's help to spread the word. It's so helpful that NGS is doing this educational session and that they will share it later. But you know, we're just doing as much as we can, and that's why we're asking folks to help. I want to clarify one quick question I saw is, first, you submit your comment, and then you would send that same comment to your senators and representatives. Super important that you do both parts. If you, like me, live in DC and don't have a senator, then there's alternative ways. But I do want to emphasize, please do both of those steps, but especially submit the comment first.
And
Rich, did you
want to
say something about Roots Tech?
I will be at Roots Tech. I have 2,500 business cards waiting for me in Salt Lake City to hand out to people to provide them with information and how to access our website. I will be very happy to give some of those business cards to anyone that will be at Roots Tech and that will be happy to hand them out and discuss this issue with people. If anyone is helping organizing or doing anything at Roots Tech, I'm very happy to talk to anyone, would be happy to give any type of presentation, even if it's a booth presentation, or talk to anybody, whether it's somebody at Ancestry or anybody who walks in off the street, I'd be happy to talk to anybody about this issue.
Rich, so, if I could as well. I'm Matt Menashes, Executive Director of NGS. I should mention as well, there is a group of organizations called the Records Preservation and Access Coalition, which Jan Allen's nodding her head. She serves on the steering committee. Barbara Matthews, who I see on the screen, serves on the steering committee with me as well. There will be a sign-on letter coming from RPAC, Fred Moss also there, to genealogy organizations for the organizations to sign on. That's where we can start to get some cumulative numbers for the number of members of each of those organizations and begin to report on that as well. So look for that if you're involved in leadership in a genealogy society or organization. Look for that sign-on letter in the next couple of days, and we'll be getting those organizations signed on so we can report that into USCIS and to the Hill as well. Thanks.
Thank you, Matt. And I'd just like to have our three speakers give brief closing remarks and to say to our members and guests, please stay on. We will just continue to talk about this issue and others, but right now let's hear from our three guests and closing remarks.
I'll start.
Hey, Marianne.
Well, we just thank you so much for this. And I think, you know, Renee mentioned a phrase that is so important to remember, that records do not preserve themselves. If you go to archives and repositories and are so grateful to see the records that are there available to you, remember that people want to see these records in the future too and more. And it's our job to make sure that they're going to be there. So thank you again.
Thank you, Marianne. Rich?
Thanks so much to NGS for having us this evening. We're really grateful to be able to talk more about this issue. As you can imagine, we're happy to talk to anyone and everyone. So it's nice to get a large audience to be able to communicate the urgency of this matter. It's great to talk to lots of people all at once. We really encourage you to check out our website. We tried our best to put a lot of good information on there and make it easy to follow. And we also encourage folks to not only get involved in this issue, but to stay active, to learn how more about how to engage your senators and your representative. I'm here down in the DC area researching at both of the National Archives facilities this week. And, you know, it's interesting to hear from some folks of my colleagues at the archives about, you know, some of the issues the archives has with underfunding and things like that. And so there's lots of different ways that we can get engaged, and there's lots of important issues all the time. So this is the one that we hope that you get familiar with and that you take action on in the next few weeks. But we certainly also hope that you will continue to stay activated and engaged in these types of advocacy issues, because you know, the records don't just show up on Ancestry or Family Search. You know, they've gotta be preserved and they've gotta be sent to the right places. And so if you wanna continue to access these records, we really need to speak out to make sure that we don't lose access.
Okay, and Renee?
Really don't have a lot to add that Marian and Rich have not already covered. I think we've said it quite a few times, but recordsnotrevenue.com is where you can go to get information about the issue, working with USCIS Genealogy Program. And you find, you know, find something that you want to get engaged and run with and build the community around to help you. It's so important, and spread the word. You know, someone who couldn't make it tonight, let them know about the recording. Let them know about the website. Let them chase Rich around Roots Tech and his recordsnotrevenue.com business cards. They're very bright. I don't think you'll miss them. and again, thank you all so much.
Okay, thank you. And thanks to the participants for asking those wonderful questions. We're going to close out this session. And members, you are welcome to stay on if you just want to talk about this issue.
Thank you, everybody.